special feeling that become memories. Favorite melody, song in harmony, lyrics that will tell your story. Come and join the adventures that we now share.
Hello, my name is Wendell Phipps, and you are tuning in to the Songs of Our Lives. Our next guest is Philip Séguin, who is one of Canada's most sought-after professional trumpeters. He has enjoyed an illustrious career performing with various orchestras and groups across Canada, including Winnipeg, Thunder Bay, London, Toronto, and Windsor Symphonies, as well as 20 years in the orchestra for the Stratford Festival Theatre. He will be interviewed by longtime friend and colleague, Ian Smith, as they discuss the music of Phil's life.
Hi, Phil.
Hey, Ian.
How you doing?
Well, thank you very much.
It's great to have you here.
Thanks for having me here. Yeah.
You know, I call you one of my oldest friends. We go back to, like, I think 1981.
81 was when we met in first year university.
That's right.
That's right. University of Windsor.
Yeah.
Class of... I don't know.
Well,
81 anyway.
That's what I don't know how long you stayed there. I hung on a little longer, I think.
There was a lot of work to do. It took me 5 years to do it.
Took me eight. Mm-hmm. And it took me eight because I wanted to take all of the courses. I wanted to take all of the orchestra. Remember how they were split? Mm-hmm. And you could only take orchestration one. Mm-hmm. And then the next year you could take orchestration two, etc. Yeah. So I stayed a little longer because of that. Anyway, we're not here to talk about me. We're here to talk about you. We're here to talk about the music of your life, the role music has played in your life. And now, it's played a huge role in your life because of the fact that you're a professional musician and have blazed an amazing trail doing that. But, you know, I would like to just talk about your early life and the role music played in your early life. Was there, was there music in the house? Was it in church? Where did music find you in your early years?
Yeah, well, that's a good question because, I do get asked that quite a bit, I'll be, because my brothers are also, they're musicians and people ask, oh, was there music in the house? Was there, it's a good question.
Yeah.
And, I guess the answer to that is, yes, but no. I mean, there was nobody, my mom or dad wasn't, they weren't great musicians, and they weren't, there wasn't a piano in the house, but there was a lot of music, and that my grandmother, I grew up at my grandmother's house, and she had records, records, right. And she would listen to her favorite songs, so there was a lot of music, and we went to... my mother's Macedonian, so we would go to the Macedonian vecherinkas, so the kind of the village dances and parties and stuff. And they would have them at the Teutonia Club and at the Kabota Club like that.
Right.
And there was always a band.
Yeah.
There was always a live band.
Oh, cool.
And I always gravitated towards the music. So when the band was playing, I would sit up beside the drummer and I'd wait for him to break a stick, because he was a hard... Macedonian drummer, and he'd always break a stick, and so I would give him another one.
That's awesome.
And so then I wanted to be a drummer, and so that kind of thing. But even still, I mean, I remember when we were growing up, there was CKLW, the Big Eight.
Mm-hmm.
And my mother had a clock radio that someone had given her, and I'd always listen to the radio. I could sit there all day listening to the radio.
Cool.
And I would listen to all those tunes. Remember the Carpenters and all the Motown stuff. And all that. So I just gravitated towards that, and I would get lost.
Oh, that's wonderful.
When I was a bad boy, my mom would send me up to my room. And I'd go up to my room, and she'd say, "Oh, you can come out now." And I'd say, "No, I'm fine.
I'm fine."
Because she would come up there, and I'd be singing away.
Oh, that's awesome.
I'd be singing away, and I'd be having the time of my life.
Cool.
So. When it came time to that we were in elementary school, and Philip Haddad was our principal.
The father of sax player Dean Haddad.
Haddad, and I believe he had a sister Karen, who was also fast forward to the Optimist band. There, she was in the Optimist Youth band.
Oh, cool.
So Philip Haddad, as our principal, he had the option of sending kids to an instrumental music program at St. Anthony's. And so what happens is that all the kids from around the city would get bussed into St. Anthony, and Rose Jobin would teach. She would teach. All of a sudden we'd have a concert band, like 30, 40 kids, and maybe five from our school, a few from St. Anthony, a few from, mm-hmm. you know, whatever school, St. Francis or something. We'd all go, I don't know how many times a week, maybe it was once a week or twice a week maybe, and we would go there and we'd have band class. Cool. And then we'd come back to J.A. Rooney School, where I was, and I had missed French class, see? Because everyone else was in French class, and I was at music, so I'd write a test. And I remember writing the test, and it was a bunch of words, and it would say magazine. And I would say magazine, you know, which of course is not a store. You know, but I didn't know that. So that's why Mr. Segan didn't speak French.
Yeah, yeah.
But then when I, of course, I could think for myself, oh, okay, I'm a Segan. But anyway. I digress. But so there was music around me. And I always gravitated towards that. And I remember my mother, she bought me, for Christmas once, a little plastic violin. Because I think we were watching the, what was it, Don Messer? You know, the Canadian fiddler?
Yeah, yeah.
You know, because we had, you know, Channel 9 and and then a few American stages, you know. So I gravitated toward that. Or and I got a little Swissbach, a little accordion.
Yeah, okay.
A little plastic one, again.
Right.
And I would just think back and forth, you know. And the Partridge Family albums.
Oh,
see, you know,
that was huge.
Yes, and I used to do my own favorites.
I think I love you.
Yeah, there you go. And there's, when you look at it, those are all studio musicians. So yeah, those were great bands, great musicians on there, and David Cassidy, you know, great musicians. And
sounds like you had like a nice blend of pop music, you know, Motown, R&B, and the ethnic music.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah,
yeah. So it was all music to me.
Mm-hmm.
It was all music to me. I certainly didn't know anything about classical music,
right.
You know.
Right.
And but as far as all my music was whatever, I guess the mediums, whatever I was being fed, you know. And again, the live music that was at those Macedonian dances.
Right? So I imagine then, is that where you picked up the trumpet in elementary school?
Yes. Okay. Yeah, I originally started on the drums, the snare drum.
Right.
You know, and because it was the Maurice D. Taylor Easy Steps to the Band.
Yeah, I remember,
you know,
that book.
Remember that book?
Yes.
And so, you know, all the band, they would be, the band, all the wind instruments would be learning, you know, how to produce a sound, the fingerings, the certain notes. And I'd be sitting back there and it'd be right, two, three, four, left, two, three, four, right, two. And I'm like, you know, this is for 3 months. And so Rose Jobin
pretty came, boring.
Pretty boring. Well, Rose Jobin came up to me and she said, Mrs. Jobin, she came up to me and, you know, and I loved her, you know.
Mm-hmm, this, great educator.
Oh, great. And she said to me, she said, you look bored back there. You want to play anything else? I said, well, I'll play the cornet like my friend Steve. Stephen Amdari. And I said, she said, okay. And so for the second half of the year, I played the cornet. Well, they'd already learned their fingerings and stuff,
right. And
how to make a sound. So I'm watching them play. I remember Twinkle Twinkle is in that book,
right,
and I remember I didn't know the fingers. I'm just watching, you know.
Right.
And I was
so you
just
played catch up a little bit.
Played catch up, and then the next year she said, "Oh, we need French horn players," and I went, "Oh, I'll play French horn," and that was the kiss of death.
Oh,
you know?
Man, literally,
you know,
that embouchure.
Yeah, and you put one finger down, you get 19 different notes.
Oh, of course, yeah,
you know,
yeah.
And the horn's so big. And then I didn't enjoy that. But then I started doing drum and bugle corps, and I played the bugle, the soprano bugle, which was like a trumpet mouthpiece. It was a trumpet mouthpiece. And then I just, in third year, grade eight, I asked her, I'd like to play the trumpet. She said, fine.
Do you think playing the French horn with the very small, and like, do you think that helped your embouchure?
I don't know because I don't know how much of an embouchure I had back then.
Right.
But I think probably the fact that I got so frustrated on the French horn, and maybe everybody should play French horn because then when they go to a normal instrument, to a regular instrument like the trumpet, where, you know, you put one finger down, you might get two different notes, because the partials are so...
Hey, wait a minute, I play piano, I put one finger down, I only get one note.
That's right.
I haven't made.
Yeah. So I think in that manner, it probably did help me when I played the trumpet, because the trumpet was so much easier after that. Really, cool. I really believe that. French horn's a difficult instrument. It's a very difficult instrument. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So then that was in elementary school, and I guess, so you must have just followed the natural progression going into high school, playing in the high school band.
I did.
Now, where did you go to high school?
I went to Assumption College School, Assumption High School.
And was, remind me of the music teacher there.
Henry Boone. Yes. Henry Boone was there, and he was my...
Fine man.
Now, it was, Henry Boone did all the music classes except for the senior band. And Gil Grassuti.
Oh, of course.
The late, great Gil Grassuti, he would come in to do the senior band.
Okay.
And
was he an itinerant music teacher?
Well, he was kind of, from my understanding, is that he was kind of left over from the old days when you could still teach there if you didn't have a teaching degree. Because he never did go to school to get a teaching degree. He was too busy gigging.
Absolutely.
Doing the Elmwood Casino, doing all the TVG's other place, all these, you know, all these shows and stuff. And Gil was doing that. But everybody loved Gil.
Oh, yeah.
So it was like, they just kept him going. And then eventually Gil retired and stuff. But so I had Henry Boone first. And he was great, you know, very very strict, and you had to know your scales. You had to practice your scales, and I didn't practice my scales.
No,
you know, in grade 9, because I thought I was good. Mm-hmm. You know, I could play the trumpet, right? And
imagine you had a good ear, so you could just.
I think I had a great ear because I couldn't read that well.
And you hear it once, and you could play it, type of thing. I bet.
Yeah, I could, and. I remember on a report, I still remember on the report, he wrote, he must practice his scales daily. Yeah. And I didn't do that for years until I got to university.
Really?
And then I remember, okay. And to this day, Ian, I kid you not, to this day, I practice my scales every day. All my majors, all my minors, all, I put diminished, I do all that stuff. You got me doing
that.
You got me doing diminished scales.
Of course.
You remember that.
Yes.
And I do them every day. And I think of Henry Boone every day that I do that. Oh. And then Gil was, when I got into the senior band, well, Gil was a musician, right? So we would just read charts.
Right.
That's
on,
all we
right
did.
Right on. You know,
we would rehearse them, but in Gil's way, Gil treated everyone like a professional musician, you know?
Right.
Even though you were just maybe a beginner.
Yeah.
And so we'd get, you know, close to the concert time, he'd give us a list of pieces that might be on the concert.
That might be.
You know, these kids that are like not really used to that, you know. No, it was a great education. It was a great high school education. Mm-hmm. And all the way through there, too, I was doing drum and bugle corps and marching band during the summer.
Okay.
And so, you know, so in grade 9, so I, you know, when you go away for summer vacation or summer break, most kids, they don't touch most kids.
Of course.
None of the kids would be touching their horns.
That's right.
But I would be playing for 5-6 hours a day, marching on a football field,
wow,
and doing parades, doing shows, playing a brass instrument, 5-6 hours a day. Wow. So when I got back in September.
Oh, you were the man. Yeah.
I'm this much better
or
more advanced, I suppose.
Right, of course.
Then the kids, certainly that. And you know, a brass instrument, you can't just... put that down. I don't have a gig till next Saturday. Okay, I'll pick it up next Friday.
Yeah, forget about it.
You can't do that.
No.
And so, because of that, and you compound that by every summer.
Yeah, yeah.
And then all the extra stuff that I was doing during the school year.
Right.
Then I was just that much better, and or like I say, advanced. Not better, just advanced.
And well, better skilled, you know, because
sure, because I was just doing it.
Exactly.
I was just doing it more often. And any of the other kids could have been just as advanced. I like that word. Or skilled, but they didn't put in the amount of hours that I did, and so So then when it came time to university, fast forward to university, it was a no brainer for me.
And and you obviously did not peak in high school because, gosh, your career has been long. And in university, well, I remember we played in wind ensemble together.
We did.
Yeah, that was awesome.
I'm going to take a little sip of coffee here because Lois here was kind enough to bribe me with coffee. Let me just try this.
Notice the Beatles coffee mug.
Yes. Oh, honey, that's great coffee. Thank you, Lois.
So,
Yeah, we played in wind ensemble together.
We did.
I remember I was a euphonium player. I played euphonium in
with James Tamburini.
Well, and I was just going to mention, what an amazing instructor.
Who gave you your AKA.
Oh, he sure did. Jan Sibelius.
Jan Sibelius.
Yeah.
Came from James Tamburini.
It sure did.
There you go. He called you Jan.
Yeah. Oh, God bless him. What a wonderful man. James Tamburini. Talk about a professional, like, you know, you must have had, so because you had Gil, he right. sort of gave you that little professional upbringing, and then to jump yes. to James Tamburini. List some of his credentials.
Tamburini's?
Yeah.
Wow. James Tamburini. Well, he was, he grew up in Philadelphia. Mm-hmm. His dad was a bandmaster. And so there was always a horn around the house, you know. And he grew up in one of these long, narrow apartments where the kitchen was in the middle. And so his dad would leave a trumpet on the kitchen table so that every time he went from one end of the apartment to the other, you had to stop practicing the trumpet.
Oh, that's hilarious.
Him and his brother were both trumpet players. He says his brother was even better trumpet player than him. But, you know, he took it. He was like, it came easy to him.
Yeah,
Tamburini
yeah.
had to practice. You know, James Tamburini had to practice. So he said you couldn't pass by the kitchen without playing the trumpet. And he said you start playing trumpet and you forgot why you're going to the other side of the room. The other
I
side
love
of the
it.
Apartment. You know? And so uh-huh. he was Philadelphia, and so he auditioned for the Curtis Institute,
right.
which back then, I'm not sure if it's still like that now, but back then you couldn't, Tamburini would say, hey, you know, you had $1 million. If you had $1 million, you couldn't get it. It wasn't until it was all scholarship.
Right.
So everybody was scholarship. And who was one of his classmates was Leonard Bernstein.
Leonard
Bernstein. And I think a little later, Samuel Barber went there. And
wow.
But lots of big, great musicians went there. Tamburini, and this was Philadelphia, and so he studied, like everything that you study in a university music program, but he studied phrasing with Marcel Tabuteau, who was the principal oboe of the Philadelphia Orchestra.
Wow.
And that's where a lot of Tamburini's phrasing and his music knowledge came from.
Do you remember his use of solfeggio?
Oh yeah, it was flawless.
Yeah.
Italians grew up that.
Right.
If you're Italian, you grow up, you know, learning music. That's like learning how to speak.
Instead of I'm going to the street, going to the store, it's do re mi fo. You know.
That's right. That's how they would talk. Mm-hmm. While at Curtis, Fritz Reiner was the conducting professor,
wow.
and Tamburini came to his. Tamburini was there, and so was Fritz Reiner. Fritz Reiner was the conductor of the Pittsburgh Symphony there. So when there was a trumpet vacancy in the Pittsburgh Symphony, this was back in the days when a conductor could invite someone, and boom,
right.
you're
right.
my principal trumpet.
Right.
So that was Tamburini. Boom. So Tamburini, I think he was 21 or 22 years old, was the principal trumpet of the Pittsburgh Symphony.
That's huge.
In like 19... I used to know the dates really well. Probably 1940, 41. I'm wrong with the dates, but anyway, it's around that era.
Yeah.
It was maybe even a little bit later than that, because he played with the American Symphony Orchestra under Leopold Stokowski.
What? That's huge.
Yes, Tamburini did. And again, he was handpicked, and he was one of four trumpet players back then. Yeah. And that was a wartime orchestra, that's right. So that was the American Symphony Orchestra. Then was Pittsburgh. And then after that was... He was appointed principal trumpet of the Detroit Symphony from 1944 to 1966.
You know,
all along the time, he would go to New York and they would play Radio City Music Hall, fill in for Harry Glantz of the New York Philharmonic. I mean, all these things. I mean, just, it's a huge...
Well, the reason I asked you to list his credentials is because as your teacher, he must have passed all that along to you.
Well, he tried. I mean, as much as you can.
Yeah.
You know, all that knowledge in such a, you know, you got to boil it right down, you know. Oh, wait, he was one of those charismatic characters, right?
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
You know, when he walked into the room, you knew it.
Oh, yeah.
You know, he was just a short stature guy, mm-hmm. but when he started telling stories of Toscanini, you know, of Stokowski, of Fritz Reiner, of, you know, Paul Perret.
He stood on the shoulder of giants, you know.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah.
And
remember
had,
the suits, the tuxes he used to wear?
Oh, yeah, he was just flashy. He was flashy as a conductor. But we always knew, and you just listen to any of those recordings, and there is a, he always used to say, with conviction. Mm. With conviction. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Play this with conviction, you know. Mm-hmm. And you listen to his playing on those records, and it's with conviction. And he didn't play much during our lessons because he had teeth problems. That's why he retired. Okay. He had teeth problems. They started drilling up and all this stuff. He was like a guinea pig. They didn't know anything about it. And so he couldn't play the trumpet anymore. That's when in 66 he retired, and I believe in 67 is when the University of Windsor opened up a music school. So they got to conducting brass,
what a win for the University of Windsor.
Big win.
And a win for us. You know,
absolutely.
And I just want to mention something. A few years ago, you conducted something at the University of Windsor. It was our reunion concert.
Yes.
And I swear I was watching James Taylor.
That's what somebody else said.
Oh, it was awesome.
That's what Fazcash said, Bob Fazcash.
Yeah.
So, yeah, it's like watching Tamarini. Well, I mean, sure, you watch a conductor for so many years.
That's right.
And that's what it... You know, and in the lessons, he was dancing around us, you know. Mm. If you were playing well, he would be dancing in the room.
Yeah.
If you weren't playing well, he'd be like, meh. He'd go, meh, you know, that kind of thing. Mm-hmm. So he was always conducting. He was always conducting. So that, yes, that's, and I'm a huge observer of things and of people and stuff. So I can easily absorb those things.
What other university professors do you feel really, really moved you, helped you along?
David Palmer.
Oh, of course.
David Palmer was, he's retired now. He's still around. He's in Victoria. He retired in Victoria. Mm-hmm. He's from out there, actually. That's where he's from. David Palmer, he was the organist at All Saints Church. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And what he would do is he would take the students and he would have them play on Easter, play for Christmas, mm-hmm. play for a wedding, play for this, blah, blah. And then after a while, so I worked with him quite a bit, you know. He was great to work with. It was like having a lesson. When you play with David Palmer, it's like you're getting another lesson. Yeah. See, it was like a lesson. It was a lesson. Yeah. And so I remember years later, I ran into him. I said, it's okay to call, it would be Mr. Palmer, Mr. Professor Palmer, Professor Palmer. And then after a while, I think we started working together. That was really weird. So I just started calling him David, you know. And that was pretty strange.
It was strange for me too.
But it just seemed natural, you know. And so I said, "Hey, David," I think it was in the hallways of the University of Windsor, the old bowling alley. And I said, "How come you don't ask me to play for you anymore?" You know. So we got the percussion ensemble from the student. I went, "Oh, that's right, of course. Yeah. That's why, because he uses the students."
Of course.
To give them experience, to give them training and stuff. I went, there you go. So if I wanted to play with him, I had to hire him. So we did. I did that a few times. And he would still call me now and then to do stuff. But David Palmer, for sure. David Palmer, huge. Big influences. Ed Kovarik, Harvard grad. Pulled no punch. I was telling a student of mine on Monday, I teach at York University, just trumpet students, and classical trumpet students, and I was telling a student of mine, because a student of mine had a question, and the question, I can't remember the question offhand, he was doing a jury piece, and I suggested that I wanted him to play something lyrical, and then something technical, for the jury, and then scales and other things. And so he wants to play the Ave Verum Corpus, the Mozart. I said, that's a great piece, for sure. It's great because you get phrasing and stuff in there, and you have to play lyrical, you have to sing, you get to play Mozart. Mm-hmm. So his arrangement was in B flat. It was really low. It was really low. And I suggested it because he found it on the internet for free, right? Yeah. It still says specimen on there. You know? It's probably missing two bars, but anyway. Mm-hmm. So I said, I said, you should play that. It'd be nice in E flat or even F. I think the original was in F or E flat. I'm not sure, but it's not way down there. It's
right.
You know. And he said, "Oh, you think I?" So I said, "Well, maybe I can find them there." I said, "Well, I tell you what. I said, you look, and I said, I'll look, and then on Monday we'll compare notes.
Cool, cool.
And who used to do that? Ed Kavark. Mm-hmm, Ed Kavark would do that. And 99.99% of the time, the student wouldn't look it up. But Ed Kavark did.
He did, yeah.
He would always look. Because Ed Kavark, if you didn't know something, he'd say, I don't know. If he had a question, he'd say, I don't know.
Didn't he do the drop the needle test?
Yeah, he would do the drop the needle thing. Back when you could drop a needle. And boy, he could drop a needle and go.
Yeah, yeah.
Well, you know, identify this piece of music, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. I think we had an amazing music education.
Oh, and then Wayne Jeffrey. I can't not say a good thing. I mean, Wayne Jeffrey was great. He brought it to another level because he was also doing his doctorate at Eastman and stuff. So he was right into the music education thing. So he didn't put up with anything, any kind of, no excuses. But Tambrini didn't either. But certainly from Wayne, I was like, no, blah, blah, blah. And man, you have to work. You have to work. Remember conducting with him.
I took conducting with him.
I remember, yes. And he was tough. Mm-hmm. And it was all great because I still, when I look at a score, I still look at it the same way.
So do I.
I still analyze it.
I break it down the way he taught me. Yeah.
There you go.
Yeah. I mean, we met in university and we had so much fun there. And there was five of us that used to hang out and study on, what can you believe it? We would study on Monday nights. At the grad house, of course.
Or somewhere, but we would study, and then we'd have the Tuesday morning quiz.
That's right.
In Ed Kavark's class.
That's right, yeah. It was a great time. Yeah. Now, that was in the 80s.
Yes.
And so, can you talk about your transition from university, and maybe this was even during university, to professional gigs around town?
Well, it was in university. There was a place called the Top Hat.
Oh, of course.
You remember the Top Hat. And the Top Hat was sort of one of the last nightclubs. Mm-hmm. I guess you call them nightclubs where there was a...
Or a supper club.
Supper club. Yeah. Where there was a show, a floor. I don't know what a floor show is, but I guess there was a stage and there would be entertainment there. There would be the singing acts. You know? So it was kind of a holdover from the old days. Of the Elmwood and the Metropole. Mm-hmm. And then it was actually Mike Drakus was the... He owned the Metropole, if I'm not mistaken. The old California's, whatever it is now. It was a roadhouse.
Walkerville Eatery now.
Okay. Mm-hmm. That was the Metropole, right? And so the Top Hat wanted to kind of reinstitute, at least revive.
Yeah.
Revive the old acts that would go through the Elmwood Casino back in the Sinatra days and Sammy Davis and...
So who were some of the people you played with?
Well, some of the people that I played with were a lot of the ones that were, again, they were in, well, actually they were probably my age now, but they were in the sort of the end of their careers, you know, the autumn of their careers, I suppose. Jerry Vale.
Oh, yeah.
Did you do
Frank Gorshin?
Frank Gorshin. Wow, Frank Gorshin, the Riddler on the Batman. Remember Frank Gorshin? Mm-hmm. Frank Gorshin, he was a great singer. He was a singer before he got into acting. Well, they all sang and danced and acted. They were all triple threats.
Of course.
All of them back then.
Back then.
Because they all had a foot in vaudeville.
Yeah.
You know, they all sort of are coming out of that tradition.
Right.
And we played a couple of old vaudevillians. These guys were in their 80s, you know. But remember Frankie Rapp from Detroit. Mm. This comedian. I mean, he probably didn't last long much after that. But this guy was right out of vaudeville, you know. And so that was great. Like I said, Al Martino, Frank Gorshin, Guy Mitchell, Mr. B, Billy Eckstein.
Wow.
Billy Eckstein, of all people.
I heard, and I didn't play this show, but I know, he was, I just had his name. Anyway, it doesn't matter. There are so many of them. The older guy, Mickey Rooney.
Oh, yeah, Mickey Rooney. I never played Mickey Rooney. He came to the top.
He came to the top.
Okay, that's great.
Now, that might have been after you left, because...
Yeah, it was, because I sort of went... Yeah, and Sid Caesar came. I didn't play Sid Caesar.
Yeah.
But he came, and, Peter Marshall, you know, the Hollywood Squares guy.
Oh, yeah, I forgot about him.
He was a boy singer, too. He was called the boy singer. I think he's still alive. Wow. I think he's like 101 or something.
So, you know, the Top Hat, and just, I remember you and I did a duo.
That's right.
We played around town, you know,
doing
jazz standards.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And you remember how that started, was where we would be jamming late at night at the university.
Yeah.
See, we knew how to get into the university. We had a key.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
The door was... ajar all the time.
You could easily open the door, even though it was locked, because it was a removable post,
yeah.
So that they could move grand pianos in and out.
That's right.
Yeah,
right.
And then tighten it. Well, eventually everything comes loose, you know, if, you, yeah. if it's removable. And so you figured out how to get into the university late at night.
Yeah.
And so we would jam late at night until the wee hours of the morning. And then after jamming for so many nights, weeks, months, we said, hey, why don't we just get paid to do this?
Yeah.
Remember that?
Yeah.
It was like an epiphany. Mm-hmm. Like, wait a minute. We're pretty good.
Yeah. Yeah. And then we did Toot Suite. Club bowling suite.
That's right.
And I remember they said that we were the only musicians that had ever improvised
intentionally
in a recital. Yeah.
In a recital. Yeah. Well, Kevin Good said that about you. About you.
Okay.
He said that about you.
Okay.
He said you're probably the first musician to improvise in this recital hall, intentionally.
Yeah.
Yes.
Some other local band. Well, I mean. The locals.
Well, yeah,
we played in the locals together.
The locals, we played in the locals, yeah. And that was in the early 90s
mm-hmm.
when we wanted to play the music that we grew up with. Right,
exactly.
And back then, yes, there was, well, even back then, I mean, we were a seven-piece band.
That's right.
Seven-piece band to be working in a nightclub was pretty rare. So we worked for less, I remember, but we were always
working. A little less, but it was great.
Well, we were always working, yeah. So we played all that Chicago Blood, Sweat, and Tears.
Yeah.
All that stuff, all that horn band stuff, and that was a highlight. That was a highlight.
So yeah, we played all that great music, and with our friends, you know. Mike Stone was there, and you know our university friends.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that was a great band.
Mm-hmm.
Now, but that was after something. I remember you went out of town before that, though. Were you not with didn't you go to the Winnipeg?
I was playing in the Windsor Symphony. I was playing in the Windsor Symphony Orchestra my audition for the Windsor Symphony was at the beginning of third year university. So I got into the orchestra in Windsor in third year university, right at the beginning. So that was sort of my beginning of my professional experience.
Right.
Yeah.
Okay, cool.
So that's one reason why it took me a little longer to do a university degree and stuff. But anyway, after I graduated from university, I was still practicing, you know, and I got really into the orchestral thing, orchestral excerpts, and
mm-hmm.
figured, okay, I gotta, you know, and so there was a Winnipeg Symphony audition for third trumpet. It was like a third utility, so it was, they moved you around and stuff. And it was a one-year position, and so I thought, well, you know, that's a full-time orchestra, it's a big orchestra. You know, it's like, you know, I'm kind of going from junior A or whatever to the NHL, you know?
Yeah, yeah.
So I figured, okay, I'm going to do it. And and I won the job, you know, for 1 year. And there was a great thing for me because it was a full-time orchestra, you know, doing, they did heavy duty stuff.
Yeah,
they
yeah.
did Strauss and Mahler and all that mm-hmm. stuff. You know, I wasn't really doing a lot of that because Windsor's a smaller, you know, orchestra stuff, which is fine. We did mostly Beethoven and Mozart and
mm-hmm.
Mr. Beethoven.
There's Beethoven.
You know, and Mozart and stuff like that, you know, which is great. And then we still did other things, but we can't really do the big Strauss pieces or the big Mahler and all that if you don't have the forces. You know?
Did they still have the Philharmonic Choir when you were in Winnipeg? Because my mom sang in the Winnipeg
I think it's still there.
Yeah, because sure. I remember I grew up in Winnipeg mm-hmm. before I came to Windsor. And
mm-hmm.
Yeah, and they had the Royal Winnipeg Ballet and
absolutely
and cultural city.
Yeah.
But you know, we shared a studio at that time.
We
remember
did.
On University,
yep.
right across from Skippy's Donuts.
Yes, yeah, Kitty Corner from there.
Or Kitty Corner, yeah.
It was attached to a Greek,
yes,
grocery store.
Yes,
what was his name?
Oh gosh,
Nick. I don't know. I have no idea. Because it was like a hair salon after that. Afterwards.
That's right.
So before
yeah.
and after.
Yeah.
But what was the? It was in,
oh, and it's something else now.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, I think
we
so.
We did. We shared a studio.
Yeah, those were some fun days.
Yeah, and we got a lot of work done there too.
Did we ever?
You know, yeah. we did.
Winnipeg.
Yes.
For you.
Yeah.
How long was? So tell us about.
It was one. It was 1 year.
Yeah, 1 year.
It was always going to be a one-year position. So when I came back to Windsor afterwards, I really didn't have anything. So I went to, you know, I took a day job. It's basically what I did. I went to London. Eric Schultz, a teacher of mine, he started the CD distribution company. And so he said, well, I need an office manager. So he wanted to distribute his discs because no one else was. So he wasn't happy with the distribution. Okay. So he decided to start, that was when CDs were, everybody was buying CDs.
That's right,
So these things were flying off the shelves. So he said, I need an office manager. So what I did was I worked there. And then I would practice at night and stuff. And then eventually, the Symphony in Windsor, the audition, the position that I had vacated. So I got my old job back.
Oh, great.
And then after that, I went to Thunder Bay for half a season. And then I auditioned for the Foothills Brass out in Calgary.
Which is a 96. notable ensemble.
Well, they were a full-time group. They were a full-time group, and they toured everywhere. And all over
recording
the country,
too, right?
and recording, and so I auditioned for them because I had done a lot of brass quintet stuff, and that was a great experience. That was being on the road and traveling writing arrangements in the van, just
awesome.
Reading. I read so much, all the books that I was supposed to read in high school and university. I read them all. It was a good catch up time for me.
Nice.
And then life on the road is great, but it can be taxing.
I remember you used to complain about your back because you were in the van or in the
car. Sure. It's tough on the body.
Oh yeah.
It's a young person's thing. Mm-hmm. Now that's not that old. It's not that older people are not doing that, but it's tough to be schlepping stuff.
Absolutely.
Even when we played in the Rock Band, I remember, those big JBL monitors.
Yeah.
Right? And finally I asked you guys, do you guys mind if I just wrap chords?
Yeah.
And you guys were like, oh yeah, sure. I said, you mean I could have said that 6 years ago?
I had enough equipment to move. I didn't move much PA because I had my keyboard. Sometimes two keyboards.
That's right.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And you horn players, I don't think we ever expected you to move equipment.
What was really interesting, the great thing about playing in the Rock Band, the locals, was, I couldn't patch a stereo together. Every time I would move, it's like, where do I put it?
Oh.
And then one time, you guys all had another gig. Or it was during the day, and we were setting up at Behringer's. Remember that place, Behringer's?
Of course, great place.
And so me and Mike Stone were the only ones available to set up the band, and we set up the whole band.
Wow.
We did the mics, the chords, the board. We did the drum kit. I mean, as much as we could.
Yeah.
Couldn't really test the kit, but we did. We tested the kit.
Yeah, yeah.
We set up. I think you came in and just patched in your board, and aside from a few tweaks and all that, we did pretty good. But we set up the whole band, and I thought, well, that's pretty good,
because that's coming from
someone that couldn't put a stereo together with an amp and a turntable. That was me. So
cool.
That was great.
Cool.
It was after the band that I went out to Calgary, and then
So then after that, I've got a list of cities here. So you were in Winnipeg. Yeah, you went to Calgary after the locals, right?
Correct. Yes.
And then I have written down here that you were with the Thunder Bay Symphony, which I had forgotten about.
That's right.
Now, tell us about that.
Like I said, I was on the road for 4 years for sure, 4 or 5 years, and I was getting, thinking about, okay, I want to get back into orchestra, and I was on my first tour of my fifth season, that's what it was, yes, so it was 4 years for sure, with the Foothills Brass, and I was on the first tour with of the fifth season, beginning with Foothill Rock, and we were up in somewhere in BC, and I checked my answering machine. Remember back those days, you checked your answering machine, and there was a message from the personnel manager of the Thunder Bay Symphony, basically giving me a direct entry.
Beautiful.
in army terms, a direct entry into the orchestra because somebody had just resigned.
So you didn't have to do the blind audition or anything?
Didn't have to do that. No, didn't have to do that.
Nice.
And I talked to my colleagues in Calgary. They were hip. They understood.
Absolutely.
Because they're musicians too. And I was in Thunder Bay for 2 years. Then the audition came up, and then I won the audition. for the position of second trumpet with Thunder Bay Symphony.
Okay.
And then I decided to move down to Toronto and freelance there because Diane was there. I met Diane, my partner,
mm-hmm.
and the whole point was to get down to Toronto too.
Right, so, because a lot's happening there.
Oh yeah, so if you want to, and if you want to freelance, you got to be in Toronto, basically.
Yeah.
And then once I'm in Toronto, then word gets around. It's a small musical country, as you know, and that's when Stratford called.
And they called you.
They called me on the phone. Actually, the first trumpet player there, Holly Shepherd, she called me. She had known me. She would hear me playing shows, because I was playing shows at Grand Bend.
That's mm-hmm. another thing. Oh, I'd forgotten about Grand
Bend. Yeah. Yeah. And so, which is very close to Stratford. And I was doing that for about 10 years. And she would hear me playing shows there. And the music director would always come to our shows, the music director of Stratford. Mm-hmm. So he knew of me. And so when they had a trumpet vacancy in Stratford, they said, get that guy. So,
yeah, that's
and,
awesome.
That's how I got my foot in the door in Stratford.
And I got to tell you, that's why I tell people that you are Canada's, or one of Canada's, most sought after trumpeters.
Wow.
Because, and it's got to be true. I mean, look at Stratford calls you, you know? That's amazing, right?
That's
Thunder Bay calls you.
It's pretty amazing. It really is. And hey, I don't take a light. No way. No, that's a... But trust me.
And Lois and I have heard you play. Did you do the Fiddler on the Roof?
Yes.
That was an amazing show.
Yeah.
Oh, yes. Yeah.
The Fiddler. Fiddler there?
We
did Fiddler together here.
Well, we did. Yeah.
We did Fiddler
at the University of Windsor.
Yes, we did.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Fiddler I was there. Conducting
That's
it
where
back
it was.
Then. And
yep.
Yeah, that was a great show even then. But you guys at Stratford, I remember that show. And others. There's too many to list right now. But
yeah, it's been 20 years that I've been there. So
20 years?
So chances are... When I first got there, I was, I was... like the third trumpet player, So I wasn't doing every musical, but I was doing every other one. And then I started to do every one, and then, because I usually do two musicals. So usually I would do one musical, and then, that's it. But that was enough. New Kid on the Block, that kind of thing. So, now people pass on, people retire, people do this and that, and so... It's and music direction changes, the artistic direction changes. Mm-hmm. So I've weathered a few storms there.
Right.
So but it's really it's a great place to work.
Oh,
and I'm very fortunate. Yeah.
Yeah. Well, that's wonderful.
And that's what I do. It's for all the orchestral stuff that I've done and all the other classical and jazz here and there and commercial stuff. It the great thing about a show, about a musical, is that you have to do all of those things.
That's right.
And even still, you don't know what you're going to have to do.
Yeah.
And it's like, well, if you don't know what you're going to have to do, then get this person. Because that person can do everything.
That's right.
And
that's what, now, obviously, you're that cat. You're the guy that can do it all.
People consider me that way, yes.
Yeah, well,
yes.
I mean,
you're
a legit player. A rock pop player, improvise. I mean,
Because I work at it.
Yeah.
And because I practice all this stuff every day.
That's
I'm not saying this to go, ooh, I'm Mr. Wonderful. No, that's because
it's what it takes.
That's just the way that we were brought up in Windsor.
Right.
That's
right.
The way I was brought up. And I know that if it's like, there's going to be. Even as an orchestral player playing in a symphony orchestra, if it's a pop show, there's going to be... We just did one. We did an Oscar Peterson show. There was changes there.
Did Flo sing? Was that with Flo singing?
I'm not sure if Flo was.
Yeah, I think it was.
Yeah?
She was she was in Dreamgirls, and she sang Hymn to Freedom?
Oh, no, we didn't do the Hymn to Freedom.
Oh, you didn't?
No,
okay.
I would have thought we would do that. Yeah, okay. No, we didn't do the Hymn to Freedom. We did that in a symphony by Florence Price.
Oh, okay.
Wonderful
okay.
symphony. And we did the Canadian Suite.
Oh, okay. Oh, that's a great
and
piece.
Yeah. So, and in the in one of the jazz waltz there, what's the they put a trumpet solo. There.
Cool.
And there was changes.
Cool.
I mean, the arranger had written out a solo, but
But you just played the changes.
I just played the changes. Yeah. And I pronounced it, because that's what you're supposed to do.
That's right.
Yeah. And thanks to you and jamming all those nights.
Oh.
And you know, and even when I went to Calgary, I swear, when I went to Calgary, that's when I worked on all that stuff. I really worked on that stuff.
Yeah.
On my own.
Cool.
And then there was a couple of clubs, and I would go and jam and stuff. I mean, I could talk forever. But, you know, one of the cats that was there was Gib Monks.
Gib Monks? I don't know about that name.
He was the son of Bob Monks.
Wow.
Because a colleague of mine, Dave Reed, said, come on, we're gonna go hear this guy, Gib. He's playing the saxophone. He's up on Center Street there. We're going to go bring your horn. I'm like, okay. And so we go there. And then I look at this guy, Gib Monks. This guy looks familiar. And so then we go and talk to him, and you know, he's on break, and we're, you know, I introduce myself to him, and finds out he's from Windsor.
That's wild.
And I'm like, okay. I'm looking at this guy, I went, wait a minute. He said, your dad wouldn't happen to be Bob Monks, would he? He says, yeah, that's my dad. My dad's so cool, and all this stuff. And it was just, and when I saw Bob Monks the next time at my mom's restaurant, you know, at the United, he used to go there all the time.
Yeah.
I told Bob Monks about Gib and how much. And he was just so touched that his son thought that he was a great dad.
Oh, wonderful!
You know,
cool.
It was a story. Bob Monks, Gib told me the story. He says, "Yeah, my dad. He pulled me out of elementary school 1 year, and we hitchhiked across the United States." And
what a father and son adventure!
Yeah.
Yeah.
Who else would do that but Bob Monks?
I know.
Pull his son out of school. Yeah. He's going to give him a real education. They hitchhiked across the United States and they hitchhiked back.
That's great.
And they journaled it, and it was in the Windsor Star.
Oh.
And Bob Monks gave me a copy of the article from the Star. And he also gave me, I talked to him about how I went to one of those art site things, how you could buy art. And there was those Bob Monks sketches in color of the Ambassador Bridge, the Spirit of Windsor, of Jackson Park, I think, was another one. You know, the skyline of Detroit.
He used to do pictures of musicians.
I
got one done of me.
Oh, did you?
Yeah.
Wonderful.
Yeah.
And so when I saw him, I said, Bob, you know, I went to the art site, I tried to buy your things, but they were already, somebody already bought them. He said, it's okay. Next time I came back to the restaurant, he left an envelope with my mom, and there's copy of the sketches for me.
Great guy.
You know, anyway, great guy. And,
anyway, you know, we've been talking. We could talk forever.
We could talk could do like 15 episodes.
Why don't we do that? But for now, you know, we've talked about your young life. We've talked about your school, elementary, high school, university, transition to your professional life, and what a professional career you've had. I mean, amazing, and where you've ended up. But you know what? I just want to digress for a minute. This usually we ask our guests what song they want to hear, and
I want to hear you play Waltz for Debbie.
Yeah, well, I could do that for you. Absolutely, I will definitely do Waltz for Debbie for you. But I think you know we have a mutual friend, Phil Parent, composed a guild member Phil. And he composed a piece back in university called Le Rev.
For my brother Mike.
That's right. And Mike played flugelhorn on, I think, either his grad recital or...
It was on my brother Mike's grad recital. They played it as an encore.
Yeah.
Yes.
It's a beautiful piece. And I just have a request for you.
Yes.
If you would play that piece for our audience.
Absolutely.
I think it would be a wonderful close to this interview.
That's a great idea.
Oh, thank you.
I'd love to play it. I would be honored to play it.
Well, that's awesome.
And we're going to send it up to Phil because he's a great man.
And a wonderful composer.
A great composer.
Yeah. Nice. So, Phil, I cannot tell you how this has warmed my heart seeing you again and talking and reminiscing and hearing about the things I hadn't heard about. You know?
Right, and there's a million more, as you know, because you can't cover everything in a New York minute.
That's
say.
Right.
So, you know, it's just
that's
like right. There's way too much in there.
So, well, maybe we can continue this and have a part two to this interview.
Well, the part two should be somebody interviewing you.
Okay.
How's that? Because there's a career.
Well, thank you. Thank you.
Yes.
We'll talk about that another time.
My pleasure.
My brother, thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay.
Thank you, Phil and Ian. What a great and successful career you have had and enjoyed, Phil. And from the looks of things, it doesn't appear that you'll be slowing down anytime soon. Now, normally, Phil, we would ask you to give a song request, but in this episode, we're going to ask you to fulfill a song request. We'd like to have you perform a local composer's, Phil Parent's, Le Rêve. Phil Parent is an alumni of the University of Windsor School of Music, and he composed this piece of music while classmates with Phil and Ian during university. We are privileged to hear Phil Séguin and Phil Parent as they perform Le Rêve with orchestrations by Ian Smith. We have a surprise for you, Phil. During the interview, you requested that Ian play Bill Evans's Waltz for Debbie, and it looks like he will perform that great piece for you as an extra piece of music in this episode. Thank you. Thank you, Ian, for your performance of Waltz for Debbie. And thank you, Phil and Phil, for such a moving performance of Le Rêve, composed by Phil Parent. And thank you also, fellas, for a very fun interview. Thank you for tuning in. My name is Wendell Phipps.